It's going to be an update on COVID-19. As you all know, coronavirus disease 19 is the name of the disease given by WHO in January of this year. And the virus that causes this is called severe acute respiratory syndrome, coronavirus 2. It is very similar to the SARS, which occurred in 2002-2003. Coronaviruses are enveloped RNA viruses. They are widely present in the universe. As far as humans are concerned, we know that there are at least 6 coronaviruses that cause human disease prior to December 2019. Now, 4 of these cause simple common cold-like symptoms, mild self-limiting infections. In 2002-2003, we had a severe acute respiratory syndrome that emerged from southern part of China. It spread across the world. Fortunately for us, in India, we did not have many cases. In fact, no reported case that time. But this infection is still spreading in the globe, but on a very small scale. In 2012, another coronavirus emerged in the Middle East. It was called Middle East Respiratory Syndrome. And that has spread mostly in the Middle East and some other countries. Both these SARS and MERS coronaviruses cause severe respiratory syndrome. The new virus emerged in December in Wuhan city and Hubei province of China. Actually, cases started coming in from 7th of December, and by 31st December, China had realized that it is a new disease because many people were reporting with severe acute respiratory syndrome. And they did a quick epidemiological analysis and found that all of them had a connection to an open market in Wuhan of Hubei province. So they informed the WHO, and the WHO got to know of it on 31st December, the same day Wuhan market was closed, and China announced to the world that they have a new coronavirus infection. By 7th, the virus was completely sequenced. This is the epidemic curve that you can see. Starting from December, the boxed small box in the to the left of your screen is the one where initial cases started trickling in up to 31st. From January 7th or so, the outbreak started increasing, and it reached a peak by the end of December, end of January 2020. By January 25th, WHO declared it as a global public health infection of international concern, and much later it called it a pandemic. Now, there are two curves that you can see here, the blue bars and the yellow bars. The blue bars are cases reported by the date, and the orange bars are when they were confirmed as coronavirus infection, the new one. The virus has been completely sequenced. Now, in the middle, the red letters that you see represent the novel coronavirus that has been isolated in January. This actually clusters on the same arm as the SARS coronavirus 1, which appeared in 2002-2003. But you can see there is some phylogenetic distance between the blue SARS-CoV and the new SARS-CoV. There is about 80% similarity to the original SARS virus, but it is closely related to the immediate relation is to a bat coronavirus sequence that was available in the database. This is the current scenario. I think all of you are updated with it. More than close to 200,000 cases have been reported, confirmed from across the globe, 7,807 deaths, with the European Union now being the epicenter. China has controlled the disease. Coming to India, which is in the tabular column below, the row number 3, we have had more than 137 cases confirmed. The current count is even beyond this. The novel coronavirus infection is a disease predominantly of adults. 80 to 90% of people who have got the infection are in the age group 30 to 80. Whether it's Wuhan, whether it's Hubei, whether it's China, or whether it's the rest of the world, this is the age group that gets the infection. Thankfully, children contribute to less than 10%, and it can infect old people as old as 99 or even 100, there is a case report. How does the disease manifest? This is data from 72,000 patients analyzed by WHO and the Chinese CDC. There's a wonderful report. I would like you to refer to that report. If you go to Google and type WHO China CDC Joint Mission Report, you will get access to it. It's a wonderful document. I encourage all of you to read it and get yourself updated. Among the 72,000 patients in China, when they analyzed the clinical presentation, 80% were mild self-limiting infections. That is depicted as a pyramid on the right. They usually recover within a period of 7 to 10 days. 14% get a more moderate or severe infection. Now, these people will require treatment in the hospital, but they will not require ventilatory assistance. It is 5% who are critically ill, who need ICU care, and who will need ventilatory support. And these 5% who develop critical illness are also those who have other comorbidities. First of all, they are elderly people. They are above the age of 60. And if they have other medical conditions such as diabetes, hypertension, cardiovascular disease, other respiratory chronic illnesses or cancers, they are the people who are likely to go into severe infection. Now, the clinical features from these 72,000 patients has been shown as a graph here. Fever is almost invariable. 90% of the people who have had confirmed COVID infections have had fever. The second common manifestation is dry cough, and the third is fatigue. Put together, these three symptoms, one of these three or two of these three is found in 100% of confirmed COVID infections. When the disease worsens, people develop shortness of breath. Some of them may manifest with sore throat initially, and that is about 15%. Fatigue is seen in about 40%. Myalgia, arthralgia is seen in about 15%. Diarrhea is a rare manifestation. Coronaviruses are known to cause diarrhea, but not to a great extent. As I said, those above 60 with underlying comorbidities are the ones who are likely to develop severe corona disease. What about the fatality ratio? The overall crude fatality ratio across the globe now is between 3 to 5%. Having said that, the mortality in Italy is far more than what the mortality was reported in China today. Initially, when the pandemic hits a country, the country is not prepared. They do not know, have the protocols in place for management. So initially in China, the mortality was as high as 23-24%. But the moment they started isolating patients and taking care of them in a very systematic way, the mortality has come down by 11th of February to about 3-4%. What is the incubation period? These graphs show you the median incubation period. On the left, you see a graph which tells you that the incubation period may vary from one day after contact to up to 14 days. Initially in China, they believed it was a 28 days, but after analysis of over 70,000 cases, we know now 99% of the people develop symptoms in 14 days. The median or mean incubation period is 5.2 days. This means that most people are likely to develop symptoms within 5 to 7 days. In the bottom here, you will see something called, not in epidemiological language, refers to the probability of how many patients an infected patient can pass the infection. Currently, the R0 varies between 2.2 to 4 in various parts of the world. It is only an indicator of disease spread from one infected individual to others. Having said this, this is average R0. There was this patient, #31 in South Korea, who actually, before landing up in a hospital at the end of this trail here and getting confirmed, had gone through many parts of South Korea, attending several large congregations, a wedding reception, even getting admitted in a hospital for a minor accident. This person happened to have 1,160 contacts and many of them got infected. So R0 is an average, but this patient is an exception. So we have to remember, if somebody is symptomatic and not seeking help, and they are positive, they are likely to transmit the infection to others. This shows the time course of development of clinical manifestations. After an incubation period of 5 to 7 days, the first symptom that appears is fever. And within 3-4 days, they develop a dry cough. And if they do not seek medical help, they can go on to shortness of breath, dyspnea, by about 5th day. And if they are elderly and if they are in the high-risk group, then they will need to get into hospital by the 7th, 8th day. And by 6th to 12th day, they get into acute respiratory distress and will require ventilatory assistance. For some reason, coronavirus has a predilection for the upper lobes of the lung, but it can be cause pneumonia in the other lobes as well, but predominantly an upper lobe. The classical picture in X-ray and CT scan is ground glass appearance. The CT changes take approximately 7 days, and in China, when they did not have enough testing, they had used the appearance on X-ray and CT as one of the criteria to admit patients and put them on COVID-19 treatment protocols. Where did it originate? We believe it originated from bats. Bats have had a coronavirus that is 97% similar to human coronavirus. There is another animal known as the pangolin, which is an anteater. That sequence of the pangolin virus is 99% similar to human virus. It has only one amino acid different from the human virus. So people are now trying to believe that pangolin might have been an intermediate host. Incidentally, bats and pangolins were sold in the Wuhan market. How does the disease spread? Analysis of a large number of cases, systematic analysis in China has shown that the main mode of transmission is through droplets. It is droplet transmission occurs in close clusters, and it has been noticed in families of people who are infected. 64% of the clusters in China, in Wuhan, were from familial contacts. How does the transmission occur from a droplet? When a person coughs or sneezes, he releases a large number of micro droplets which contaminate a surface for up to 1 meter in distance. And people who touch these droplets and accidentally touch their nose, eye, or mouth transmit the infection to themselves. So this is the main mode of transmission. We are all concerned with hospital transmission or nosocomial transmission. In analysis of 44,000 patients in China revealed only 3.8% of healthcare workers acquired the infection. And this also because of some breach in protocol when they were handling patients. Initial results in January showed 29% as healthcare workers are infected, but then when they analyzed the data, they sat with them, interviewed them, they found that majority of healthcare workers had got the infection from their family members. So the WHO and the Joint Mission report is very clear. Nosocomial transmission when precautions are taken is not a major mode of spread of COVID-19. Healthcare affecters, workers affected are mainly in the early course of the outbreak. Now it's only 3-4%, and they were infected more at homes. There's this huge misinformation going on in the social media that asymptomatic and pre-symptomatic people transmit infection. China did not find any such evidence, excepting in two family clusters, and Germany published a report in Science in 2020, which was withdrawn because the data collection and the analysis was flawed. What we know definitely is that the level of transmission in household contacts can be to the tune of 11%. So that is the main mode of contact. For those who are not family members and who are close contacts, it's as low as 0.5%. And in China, they did not find tertiary transmission. What is tertiary transmission? Primary transmission is acquiring infection from an infected person in a country where it is very, very prevalent, and then coming back to the country. That is primary infection. Within the country, transmitting to household contacts and other close contacts is secondary transmission. Tertiary transmission is also referred to as community transmission. At this point of time, there is no evidence of community transmission in India. I will come to that shortly. Virus has also been found in fecal matter. The exact role is not known. In a small percentage of people, they shed virus in the feces. Whether feco-oral route of transmission is occurring, we do not know. If at all it is, it's to a very small extent. And hand washing and personal hygiene should take care of it. Who is eligible for a test to be done? These guidelines are continuously being revised by Government of India. The current ICMR guidelines, you can get it from the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare website. There are three categories of patients who are eligible to be tested. The first is all symptomatic people who have undertaken international travel and have come back. They are advised 14 days home quarantine. During the time, if they develop symptoms, they are subjected to a test. And upon landing, if they are symptomatic, they are isolated and they are subjected to a test. The second category is all contacts of laboratory confirmed positive cases. They also should quarantine themselves for 14 days in their house. In case they develop symptoms, they are eligible to be tested by any of the testing centers. The third category, which ICMR has now released for testing, is healthcare workers managing respiratory distress or severe acute respiratory illness should be tested if they develop any mild symptom. So these are the three categories. Very soon, ICMR will probably in a few days permit testing of all other severe acute respiratory illnesses, people who are admitted and who are on ventilators, irrespective of whether they have come in contact with a COVID-19 patient or not. So, but that guideline would probably come in 2 days. The specimen that is collected for diagnosis is a nasal and a pharyngeal swab. One nasal swab and one pharyngeal swab. People who collect the specimen should wear personal protective equipment such as apron, goggles, mask, cap, gloves, and overshoes, because taking a swab itself may precipitate a coughing episode, and that time virus will be discharged. It has to be put into virus transport medium, much like the way we collect specimen for pandemic influenza, which we are all familiar, we have done for so many years now, and then put into virus transport medium, and that has to be put into another container which has absorbent material. In case the specimen breaks or leaks, it should not contaminate the transport container, and transported in cool pack to the testing laboratory. The test that is done is a real-time PCR for detection of COVID, the SARS-CoV-2 viral RNA. We follow an international protocol recommended by CDC. It is now done at 62 centers across the country. I'll show you a map of that. In Bangalore, it is Victoria Hospital Microbiology Department and the NIV unit that is located in Rajiv Gandhi Institute of Chest Diseases. The test itself is a two-stage testing process. In the first PCR, they screen for the envelope gene common to all beta coronaviruses like SARS and MERS. If that is positive, a confirmatory test is done. For specific genes of the new virus, they are open reading frame 1 called as ORF1 and the RNA dependent RNA polymerase gene, which is very, very specific to the new virus. Yesterday, there was news, day before yesterday actually, that ICMR had tested 820 random samples collected across the country from people with respiratory illnesses. All these people had no contact with a known COVID person anywhere outside India in the last 3 to 4 months. This was done to assess if there is evidence of community spread. And none of these 820 samples were positive. So the ICMR said preliminary information tells us that in India, community spread has not occurred. On the right is a map. You can see the ICMR testing centers. They're spread all across India in all states and union territories. What is the way public health responds for COVID-19? There were two main strategies. All countries started preventing importation of cases into their country or province. Second was to contain local transmission. This public health response rests on four pillars: isolation, quarantine, social distancing, and community containment. Preventing import of cases, all countries, including India, have placed restrictions on the people who are coming from countries. All these are notified on the Indian government website, the Ministry of Health website, and they have issued travel advisories to people. And you would have seen in the news yesterday that from Sunday to the next Sunday, for 7 days, no international flight will be allowed to land in India. So this is one of the major measures that the countries have taken. And for all those travelers who have already entered at the airports, there have been thermal screening, data collected on their history of travel, on whether they have symptoms, their phone numbers, their address, so that they can be continuously traced. I must say that the contact tracing in India has been very impressive so far. Most of the states have put contact tracing protocols in place. And if there are large number of people in a country that are infected and they are not from that country, the parent country is making arrangements to evacuate them in batches. We have evacuated from China. We are still evacuating from Iran and from Italy. And they will be quarantined. In order to contain transmission within the country, India is practicing isolation of patients. If they are symptomatic patients, they are isolated in designated hospitals. If they are asymptomatic patients, they have been asked to self-quarantine. Guidelines for self-quarantine are available on the Government of India website and are also available from various other sources, including the social media. And every day somebody contacts them to ask whether they have developed symptoms. If not, it is also their responsibility to call a designated helpline number and inform that they are doing fine. Now, this quarantine is for 14 days. Very early evidence in China, especially Wuhan, showed that social distancing is one of the major measures that helped China to overcome the outbreak. Social distancing should be practiced for a 1 meter distance. And China went into a lockdown. It avoided overcrowding by shutting down everything. You are seeing that happening in various parts of India, including our own city in Bangalore. Schools, colleges, malls, theaters, restaurants, bars have all been closed. This is because this experience came from China. and it is there in the joint mission report, and it is effective in reducing transmission. So this is something that needs to be practiced. I also have to say that every member of the society, every citizen, has a responsibility in practicing this. If you do it diligently for the next 2 to 3 weeks, we can avert a major crisis in India, because we are in the third week. We are, tomorrow is the end of the third week since local transmission was detected in India. If you practice it for another 2 weeks, we will, I'm sure, be able to contain the infection in less than 1,000, if not a couple of thousands. So this is something that I would request each of you to inform all your friends and your people who are close to you. Containing SARS-CoV in healthcare settings, the fundamental principle is to triage and source control. Hospitals, crowding occurs at OPD and emergency. Many hospitals have put protocols in place. Thermal screening has been introduced in some hospitals. At least some sort of a simple questionnaire is being administered to patients who come to hospitals. You would have seen that the government of Karnataka and many government hospitals across the country have informed that there is no need to go to the OPD or emergency if it is not required, if it's a routine health checkup, or if minor complaints, people are discouraged from going to hospital. And within OPDs and emergencies, it would be nice to have designated areas or areas segregated within the OPD or the emergency. Hand and respiratory hygiene should be practiced for everybody who enters a hospital. Personal protective equipment is not required for everybody in a hospital, but only for those who are treating a person with history of contact with the COVID person and is symptomatic who comes to your hospital. Waste management is very critical. It should be disposed of properly. So also linen. And one of the things that is found very effective is to clean all surfaces with sodium hypochlorite if it is not metal, or use any 70% alcohol-based solution to wipe the surfaces as frequently as possible. Most importantly, people who are taking care of suspected patients should report any minor symptom that they are developing, so that they can be subjected to testing and taken off the treatment protocol and isolated or quarantined. There are a series of frequently asked questions on the WHO website, who.int. They are very good. They provide answers to most of the questions. I'm just going to flash some of these and then take your questions. How does COVID spread? Mainly through droplet infection. Is it an airborne infection? The conclusion from the Joint Commission report is it is not airborne. It is predominantly droplet borne. There is no evidence to say that air in any environment is spreading the infection. And also, please be assured that it is not a disease that is spreading from asymptomatic people who are in incubation period. Having said that, people, if they have very mild symptoms, they may not even go to a hospital. They may take a home remedy or a grandmother remedy. So all people who have COVID infection do have symptoms. And common sense tells you that if the virus multiplies sufficiently in the respiratory tract, only then it will produce symptoms. And only when there is enough viral load, symptoms are seen. And only when symptoms are seen, the person coughs or sneezes, the virus comes out. So there is no need to panic that it is an airborne infection. Should I wear a mask? The WHO is very clear. Masks are reserved for people who have any types of symptoms. Just wearing a mask and going around is not going to help anybody at any time. Remember, masks have to be worn for 4 to 6 hours. A triple layered mask is good enough to protect. There is no need for an N95 mask. N95 masks should be reserved for people who are caring for severely infected COVID-19 patients. Masks have to be changed 4 to 6 hours because the moisture in the breath makes the mask wet. Once it is wet, the virus can be transmitted through water as a vehicle and it has to be disposed of properly. WHO advises rational use of mask. You can see I'm not wearing a mask. I've not worn a mask ever since the outbreak started. I don't believe in wearing masks. What is more important is hand hygiene. How likely am I to catch COVID-19? At this point of time, if you ask me, it is very less likely because there is no community spread. Having said that, if you are careless, if you touch surfaces and touch your eyes, nose and mouth, you can get infection. So most important is how aware you are, and more importantly, are you practicing the precautions that you have to take? You know, knowledge translating into behavior is a huge, huge challenge. But we have to take this opportunity to change our practices. It's a simple practice, but it takes time to develop that. What can I do to protect myself? Regularly, thoroughly clean your hands. Maintain 1 meter distance from everybody. Avoid touching your eyes, nose and mouth. On an average, people, I'm told, do it 100 times a day when they are awake. So try not to touch unless you have washed your hands. Make sure that you and the people around you follow respiratory hygiene. If you have to cough or sneeze, do it into your elbow. Don't do it into your palms. If you do it into your palms, make sure you have some kind of tissue or cloth and then dispose that off properly. Stay at home if you are unwell. That's the greatest service you will do to mankind. You don't have to come to work. If you don't work for 15 days, the heavens will not collapse and the earth will not cave in. Reducing chances of transmission. Please take care of yourself. Please be updated on all information to COVID. There's enough sources where you can get that. But use authentic sources, either Ministry of Health website or the WHO INT website. Keep up to date on all the latest guidelines and practices. A common question people ask me, because I'm a virologist, how long does it survive on surfaces? We do not know with the new COVID-19, but because it's a cousin of SARS and MERS, we know from studies conducted on SARS and MERS, it can stay on surfaces anywhere between 6 to 8 hours to several days. It depends entirely on the environmental condition. In warm conditions, the droplet may dry. Once the droplet dries, the virus is unable to infect because it loses its envelope. Coronavirus is an envelope virus, and the protein in the envelope is responsible for attachment to human cells. Once the envelope dries, the protein drops off, so there is no way the virus can enter human cells. Cleaning surfaces is more important than asking the question, how long the virus survives? I think every surface around me is contaminated until the outbreak dies. It's a position I will take. I will not believe anything that comes in media. Summary, SARS-CoV-2 is a new pathogen. It is contagious, can spread quickly, is capable of causing enormous health problems. Having said that, 80% of COVID-19 infection patients, it's a self-limiting illness and they recover, and there is no medicine or drug that kills SARS virus. There are many treatments under evaluation. The final word is not out. Random clinical trial information will be out in the first week of April. China has been able to control it. That is the good news. So it is possible to control and bring down the infections. And we have a great opportunity in India, and we should take it very seriously. And the highest level of emergency response is required. Thank you very much.